It's fascinating, Tyler. And, you know, the Republicans have not governed as if this was the case, but the core Trump base in 2016 and since is lesser educated white voters. And if you look at those core Trump supporters, they tend to be pretty anti-Wall Street. They have liked Trump for other reasons, say his immigration policy, for example. So what you have is Democrats looking for a way to make a point about income inequality, to raise money to finance some of their spending programs on health and education and childcare, that sort of thing. And they're looking at drawing a contrast by taxing wealth rather than income. So you've got people like Bernie Sanders wants to take the cap gains rate up to 54%. John Delaney, the former private equity executive and House member who's now running, says, well, we ought to match it with the income tax rate. You know, 37% would be fine there. Elizabeth Warren, to pay for her proposals, has got a wealth tax, which would involve mark-to-market taxation of capital assets even before they're sold. So Democrats are looking to raise capital gains taxes, and they're pretty full-throated about it right now.
All right, Jimmy P., let me get your view on this. There is an argument, and actually I find myself increasingly persuaded by it, that all income ought to be taxed the same. It would lower, if you did that, you would end up lowering the overall tax rate, though you would raise it on capital gains. Why shouldn't all income be taxed at the same rate? And if you did raise capital gains rates, how much would it impact the amount of capital that flows into investments?
Well, I think it's interesting if you look at advanced economies, including Scandinavia, they tax capital more lightly than income. They have Scandinavia has a lower capital gains tax. They have lower corporate income taxes, so it's not unusual. And the reason we give capital gains a tax preference is because it's a tax on savings, because you don't want that lock-in effect, and you want to equalize you know equity investment versus borrowing. So it has those sorts of reasons. Now, believe it or not, you could find economists on both sides who would call for raising capital gains tax rates if it was offset by lowering corporate tax rates. That kind of agreement, I can see that actually happening, because again, you can find people on the left and right who realize corporate taxes are really damaging. You don't want to tax investment by corporations, but yet you also don't want to penalize taxes in the United States.
Yeah, I hear what you're saying, but lately I see it going the other way, where Democrats, including Klobuchar, are out there saying, We're going to get rid of Trump's corporate tax cuts, push them back up, and use the money for something else. I'm not sure there's going to be a lot of support on the left for cutting corporate tax rates further.
Right.
No, there's definitely not.
I hope they listen more to Jason Furman and maybe Larry Summers rather than some other folks, because it would be a great idea to lower those corporate tax rates. But fine, offset it by raising capital gains rates. If you actually want to get something done, that might happen.
And Kelly, to Jimmy's point, there is a progressive argument against raising the capital gains rate to the levels that some of these Democrats are talking about. And it was made to me by Larry Summers in particular. Larry believes that levying capital gains taxes turns on a voluntary activity, that is to say the sale of the assets. Mm-hmm. If you raise the rate too high, he says 30% is the break point, you'll get fewer transactions and therefore have fewer profits, fewer gains to tax.
Right.
So he says that would be counterproductive. That doesn't mean you can't raise it somewhat. And of course, in the Obama administration where he served, they proposed to take the capital gains rate up to 28%, which was the level that it was set in Ronald Reagan's 1986 tax reform.
Jimmy, let's turn quickly to health care and what seems to be an issue of growing importance and relevance in the 2020 campaign. The president saying he wants the GOP to be the party of health care.
Well, right. It's helpful. It's extraordinarily helpful to do that if you have a health care plan. Republicans have never agreed on a health care plan. Obamacare has a lot of things in it that were sort of originally Republican ideas. I mean, the idea of subsidizing people to buy private health insurance, that's a pretty good idea. That should be any Republican health care plan. But because it's now in Obamacare, there's a lot of reluctance to embrace that kind of thing. I fear that what Republicans are doing is that they're opening the door for folks on the left to come in with a big sort of single-payer, Medicare for all style plan, and they're going to end up just where they were with Obamacare, where they end up getting something they don't want because they don't have a plan that says what they do want.